Let the Byrates hit the floor. Let the Byrates hit the floor. What is up, guys? Wrestling Premier is here. For some reason, I've always avoided watching this pay-per-view. So I've decided to watch this pay-per-view for the first time ever. I have never watched it before. I've always heard people complaining about it, saying it sucks and everything. And I'm pretty sure I agree with them because of what happened during the event. I kind of regret that decision to watch this pay-per-view, as at one point I fell asleep. But I had to talk about it since this day marks 13 years since it occurred. Here we go. December to Dismember. Before the pay-per-view, two matches were advertised. One of the matches was Eminem versus the Hardys. Now, I don't know why this match was on the card. None of the competitors competed on ECW, but then again, maybe they realized this pay-per-view was going to be horrendous and they relied on this match to save the event. December to Dismember was held in the James Brown Arena in Augusta, Georgia on December 3rd, 2006. December to Dismember had an attendance of 4,800. The event had a buy rate of 90,000. Yep, 90,000. That has to be the lowest buy rate for a WWE pay-per-view in the pre-network era. I mean, would you buy a pay-per-view that has only two matches announced beforehand? You most likely wouldn't. Unless the main event featured The Rock and Stone Cold facing off, I don't think anyone's gonna order the pay-per-view. What this showed me about ECW is that the roster is so thin. The top guys were in the chamber match, so obviously the pay-per-view was lacking. I mean, they reunited the Hardys and Eminem for this event, and they weren't even on ECW. Anyways, let me talk about the event. When the event went live, Joey Styles accidentally said that a new ECW champion will be crowned tonight. Here we go. The Hardys reunited to face the returning Eminem. Now, both these teams reunited to face off against one another. The story is that the Hardys challenged any team in the world to a match at December to Dismember. The Voodoo Keen Mafia, who were the New Age Outlaws, accepted the challenge, but obviously they never showed up, seeing as WWE was never gonna let that happen. Eminem would accept the challenge. Now, Nitro and Jeff Hardy were in the middle of a feud for a few months. The two did have some good matches. I recently watched the ladder match, and it was pretty fun. Like, if you got 20 minutes to kill, just go watch that match. It's fun. The tag match between these two teams was pretty good, and it was fun seeing the Hardys reuniting again. Melina, as usual, was screaming. Oh, God. She was so annoying. Taz loved the screaming at first, but over time, he got annoyed by it. She was constantly screaming throughout the match. Now, about the match, I loved it, although it kind of felt a bit too long. If I remember correctly, the match ended at the 31-minute mark, and the match itself did last 22 minutes, so they had to kill time as this pay-per-view was thin on star power. The Hardys won the match after Matt Hardy performed the Twist of Fate on both Mercury and Nitro, and then Matt sandwiched Eminem so Jeff Hardy could hit a double Swanton Bomb for the victory. Matt Hardy, Matt Stryker faced Balls Mahoney. Obviously, this match was made to fill time. Stryker cut a promo before that match, and he said that this match will be an Extreme Rules match. The match was kind of Extreme Rules, but it was a Stryker Rules match, which meant that it was a tight match. No hair pulling, no moves from the top rope, etc. The match was boring and I fell asleep. I heard the three count and I completely forgot Balls won. I thought Matt Stryker won. I'm not kidding. Once I started making this video, I had to make sure that Matt Stryker won. But he didn't, obviously. By the way, what the hell are those trunks? Why would you have your own face on your trunks? Taz and Joey Styles made fun of Stryker throughout the match. Those two were the stars of the match, and they weren't even in the match. No disrespect to the competitors, I was just entertained by the commentary team. Like I said, this match wasn't good. As a matter of fact, this could have been settled on an episode of ECW. Backstage, we find Sabu unconscious on the ground. Paul Heyman was frustrated that Sabu wasn't going to compete. He was complaining to the doctors, he's saying blah blah blah. Obviously, he wasn't going to compete. The fans chanted bull after witnessing this backstage segment. Elijah Burke teamed up with Sylvester Turkai, and the two faced Little Guido and Tony Mameluke. Elijah Burke. That's a name I haven't heard of in a while. The most memorable thing for Elijah Burke in WWE is obviously the New Breed, but for me it's that match against CM Punk where there were loads of botches. Like, if you've never seen that before, go search it. There was a lot of botches in that match. I did like Elijah Burke's entrance theme song though. This match once again should have been on an episode of ECW. It's not pay-per-view quality. Turkai and Burke would win this one. I don't have much to say about this one. I can't say anything about it. I just seen it and I got nothing to say about it. Turkai would be released a month later and Elijah Burke would form the New Breed. Like I said, it was uninteresting. I'm not just going into this pay-per-view and hating on it. I just don't like it. I'm bored. The next match was between Daivari and Tommy Dreamer. Daivari was being accompanied by the Great Khali. Once again, I forgot something. I forgot that Daivari managed Khali for like a year. Daivari in November of 2006 began racking up victories, and now he's facing his toughest test yet. The heart and soul of ECW, Tommy Dreamer. Once again, this match was boring. I know I sound repetitive, but it was boring. I couldn't get into the match. Daivari shockingly won the match by rolling up Tommy Dreamer and grabbing the tights for leverage. That is seriously a shocking result. I didn't think Daivari would win this. I thought Khali would interfere to cause a DQ or something like that. The innovator of violence would chase Daivari into the back where he met Khali, who got ejected earlier on, and Khali delivered a nasty choke slam on the steel steps. During all of this, some fans shouted, "This isn't extreme, it's entertainment," which got a laugh out of me. Dreamer would refuse help from the refs, preferring to get back up by himself. The match was boring, but that choke slam was pretty rough. What do I gotta say? It looked rough, it looked brutal, it looked vicious. Backstage, Paul Heyman informed Hardcore Holly that he's gonna replace Sabu. Next up was a mixed tag team match. Mike Knox and Kelly Kelly teamed up to face Kevin Thorne and Ariel. Remember when Mike Knox was a jealous boyfriend? By the way, Kelly Kelly is a face. Kelly during this time had a thing for CM Punk. She grabbed the microphone and wished the Second City Saint good luck while the jealous boyfriend was posing on the top rope. This match is probably the worst one out of all of them. I didn't like it. I don't even remember what happened during the match. Near the end of the match, Mike Knox would ditch Kelly Kelly. Payback for all the CM Punk stuff. Kelly was left alone with the vampire. Thorne and Ariel won the match. After the match, Ariel continued attacking Kelly, and then the fans chanted CM Punk. I thought he'd come up, but instead we got the beer drinking, cane swinging, woman main event hating, hardcore icon, the Sandman. Sandman whacked Kevin Thorne with a kendo stick to send him running to the back. If only CM Punk came out, it would have been much better, but this was decent. Bobby Lashley was interviewed by some girl. I've never seen or noticed her before. I just found out that she was in the 2006 Diva Search. Anyways, Bobby Lashley said that he has one goal, one mission, ECW Championship. By the way, this was right at the hour and 27 minute mark, so it was quite early for the main event. And the main event, the Extreme Elimination Chamber match. Big Show defended his ECW Championship against Rob Van Dam, Test, Hardcore Holly, CM Punk, and Bobby Lashley. Sabu was originally going to be in this match, but he got replaced. I don't really know why he got replaced. Paul Heyman would come out to cut what would be his final in-ring promo. Now, this match was originally going to be booked a different way. I'll get to that in a minute. Paul Heyman in his promo said that ECW will exist long after he's gone. Like, it'll continue long after he's gone. Like, I think he knew the writing's on the wall that he's gone after this event. Now, this main event reminds me of a certain pay-per-view. Royal Rumble 2015. The heroes got eliminated first, the villains were the only ones remaining, and one man was going to overcome the odds. This match is decent, it's just the booking that's the problem. It is the weakest Elimination Chamber match though. CM Punk was the first man eliminated, RVD was the third man eliminated. So that meant that there was only one babyface in the match. When it was time for Bobby Lashley to enter the match, he got stuck in his pod after the men that were wearing some riot gear beat the ref. Lashley would use the table in his pod to get out. Lashley broke the cage and climbed to the top of the pod. Lashley went through Test and only the Big Show remained. Now, the outcome was so clear from here. Lashley speared the Big Show to capture the ECW World Championship. Yes, yes, it's a World Championship at the time. December to this member ended 30 to 35 minutes early. So basically, the pay-per-view lasted a bit over 2 hours if you take out the intro, the promo for this match. So yeah, it just clocks in at over 2 hours if you remove those two things. I just wanted to mention how short it was. It was like one of those in your house shows. This is when it gets better. I believe in the beginning, RVD was originally going to win the title, despite McMahon hesitating at the idea because Van Dam got busted for drugs in July. Then, that idea was changed to Lashley winning the title and turning heel. That was changed too. Another idea that was proposed was CM Punk winning the title. That was shot down too. So there was another idea. CM Punk making the champion Big Show tap out in the first minute. What this means is that there's a new champion and CM Punk would become a bigger star. Big Show's also lobbying for this idea, but Vince turned down the idea. Instead, we got Bobby Lashley as a face winning the championship. As you all know, Paul Heyman quit the next day after getting into it with Vince. He told Vince that he hated the pay-per-view after Vince asked him what he thought of it. And Vince told Heyman stop being so negative, blah, blah, blah. And once the airplane landed in, I think, North Carolina, Heyman left. He went home. Before Heyman left, he caught a promo after the event with tears in his eyes. Paul Heyman praised The Big Show and said that he's getting his rematch clause on that week's ECW. Heyman would end the promo saying that he's done. This was taped after December's dismembered. Tommy Dreamer, after the event, asked for his release. Obviously, he got turned down, but it's crazy to see that a bad pay-per-view made someone want to ask for their release. From there, ECW changed. Big Show would lose the match against Lashley and go on a long overdue hiatus. Big Show needed a long break. He was carrying the brand, and he was also on both Raw and SmackDown at times. Like, when he was feuding with DX with the McMahons, he was on Raw almost every week. He was on SmackDown facing off against Batista or King Booker or whoever, and once again, he was on Raw during his mini-feud with John Cena. He deserved a break. He was burnt out. Big Show's contract would expire on February 7, 2007. When Big Show returned, he was in much, much better shape. Lashley would begin a feud with Test afterwards. If you want to know more about this mess that occurred, watch that ECW episode of WWE Untold. It's about the relaunch of ECW. It talks about how the brand was screwed from the moment RVD got caught. Now the brand became much better after Paul Heyman left. ECW after December to this member was just there. It wasn't good for a while. It became good after the 2007 draft. From there, ECW would be the most consistent show in WWE up until its end in 2010. Alright, this pay-per-view is horrible. There are pointless TV matches scattered throughout the card. If there was one TV match on the card, sure. But there's too many of them for this to be considered a pay-per-view. They could have just used the chamber at Survivor Series for all I know. Another thing that hurt this pay-per-view a lot is that it came a week after Survivor Series and 2 weeks before Armageddon. That's another thing that hurt this pay-per-view. They didn't advertise anything until after Survivor Series and there was only a week left. The chamber was disappointing due to the outcome. If the chamber match was won by CM Punk or RVD, then there wouldn't have been such a hatred, a disdain for the event. WWE noticed that they effed up and they decided to load Armageddon up with 3 main events. That pay-per-view was like an apology from WWE. It's seriously one of the best pay-per-views of 2006. I will cover it soon, so expect Armageddon 2006 to be one of my next videos.
December to dismember.
Suck. I kind of regret watching it because I didn't feel like reviewing it. I hate watching bad pay-per-views. I just absolutely hate them. King of the Ring 95, I've never watched it and I never will probably. I don't think I'm going to watch Crown Jewel. I didn't watch that one last year. If you did like this video, make sure you hit a go to sleep on the like button and perhaps a spear on the subscribe button. Peace, I'm out.